So, hi, welcome to the first vlog that I'm going to try out. The idea is that I've just cornered Ed in the office. I've asked him to join us. Thank you very much, Ed.
Yeah, very prompt.
Yeah, for a chat, nothing more, nothing less. Ed has no idea what I'm going to ask him, so this is really very honest, I suppose, feedback and Ed's thoughts on some of the topics that I'm quite interested in. The idea of the vlog is that it gives us a voice as a team, as a working environment, where maybe we can ask the questions that we're not always confident to ask. So, Ed, thank you very much for taking the time out.
Yeah. And you're assuming, Ed, that I'm going to give you the honest answer.
This is very true, Ed, yes.
Without any preparation, right? Okay.
So, you don't know about this, Ed?
No,
this
is, no, you're literally, planned. You're just literally passing my desk and you ask me, have you got 20 minutes?
Excellent. And that's as much as it's going to be.
Right.
Now, to kick off, most people know who you are, Ed. But we say, I'm going to put this in Yammer. So, okay. The idea is that maybe people out with our business might watch it as well. So, in 100 words, I'm not going to count the words, Ed, obviously, but in a very brief outline, can you tell us who you are, your role, and what you do in the business?
Yeah, great. So, currently the General Manager for Global Standards and Assurance on Matters Maritime. That's a mouthful, of course. I think people will most recognize that there's everything around assurance and vetting, right? Okay. Background, a wet career. So, I started off with a period with Shell Tankers BV, as it then existed or whatever. Done my sailing, dual certification, master's ticket and chief engineer's ticket. And then at some stage I ended up coming ashore in Rotterdam. And from that moment onwards, no looking back. I've done posting, this is actually my third time in the UK, working for Stasco. Been in Singapore for quite a bit, and I've spent some time in Houston, Texas. Yeah. Okay. So pretty much always with ships, around ships, on ships, and involved with ships. So that's where my passion, effectively, it's my competence, it's where my passion lies, and where most of my energy will probably be most effective. Yeah.
Right. That's really interesting. So even though, obviously, we know each other, Ed, I was unaware of you're such a broad spectrum of coming and going in the UK and other countries as well. So maybe some of these questions will be interesting when we reflect, not just what your job is now and where you're based, but maybe thinking about historical locations and involvement as well. Now, obviously, big push now is we are talking about human performance. And we look at the five principles, Todd Cotman's are the nine principles that we've got within Shell. And a lot of it is to do with people make mistakes and learning, etc., from that as well. I suppose thinking about people making mistakes, one, are you comfortable in sharing what I'm going to ask you? And if not, then fine, we'll move on. But is there a time in your background where you've made, you could call it a mistake, or maybe even an opportunity where you thought, I could have done that better, that you could share with us?
I think you're actually hitting on a good point there, actually, because I think personally, and I know that if you look at everything in an academic way, and if you look at all the material, what's on paper, what's been written about it, you can buy tons of book around this whole thing around psychological safety, etc., around the whole fundamental of people make mistakes, right, okay? And although that's fundamentally right, I think it goes deeper than that. It's not necessarily just about making a mistake. It's about constantly about what we do in the moment. And the day, your contract, your week, your time on board a vessel, whatever it is made up of many of those moments, almost. Like you can almost like cut every day, slice it up, and every time you're taking steps, you're making decisions, you may not even think about it, but you're taking steps, you're making decisions, you're executing actions, etc., and that will have an impact. It will have an impact on yourself, on your environment, or indeed on others. So personally, I think if we have this kind of conversations, I think it's way more important not to talk about people making mistakes, but it's about constantly doing stuff, constantly taking actions, etc., saying things or not saying things. It's that whole environment of what is called our human behavior, how we act, how we interact, what we do, what we don't do, and what we say and what we don't say. And it makes it pretty big to a certain extent, but that's what it is, because we're all humans, we're all people, etc., and we're constantly having those interactions, and we constantly make decisions. And guess what? A lot of those happens are absolutely and totally subconsciously.
Yeah.
It's almost like an automation. Yeah? And it doesn't matter whether you're the captain of the bridge or whether you're the cook in the cabin, you're constantly doing stuff. And and it's how do we get into that? And how do we get into a position where we, I wouldn't say controlling that, but making people more continuously aware of what you're doing. So for me, it's a lot about alertness. It's a lot about constantly being on your toes. And guess what? That also explains why we often have to go back to people being fatigued,
mm-hmm.
or people not being happy because they have issues either in their work or at home, etc. And if it's in your head, you can't switch it off, and it constantly influences yourself. So it's a pretty broad and very complicated scenario. And I know I've kind of like been talking for quite a while and not answered your question, right? Okay. But that comes with the risk of sitting down and having that conversation. I can probably think of several examples. I remember being on an S class, which was one of our ships. Now my phone is ringing.
These are the things that happen during this.
And I'm just sending a message and I say, can I call you later? Right?
Okay.
I remember being on an S class, and I remember that we had an issue. I got a call from a second mate. I was the chief mate. Middle of the night, got a call. I come into the control room, and we've got an hydraulic leak.
Okay.
So one of the big valves main there, and we've got a hydraulic leak. So there's hydraulic oils all over the place. So the first thing I said, get the whole crew out.
Mm-hmm.
We need to try to contain this, etc. And we did. There was rain. Ship was draining, so we were quite listed. And it. Certain amount went into the water, sheens, etc. Yeah. But since it was in the hours of darkness, I took a decision not to report it to the authorities at the terminal, etc. And we got away with it.
Okay.
And the reason I'm giving that as an example, because again, it's not about making a mistake. In hindsight, it is probably a mistake, right? Bearing in mind, this is quite a few moons ago, so the world may have looked different, and you've got a lot of more progressive insights. But at the same token, for me, that comes immediately up if I think, if I look at it now, I probably would have done that differently.
Okay, yeah.
In today's world, and knowing with what I know now, I would have done something differently.
Yeah.
Because effectively, I got away with it.
And sometimes, as you say, and I'm guessing the problem is if you get away with it once, that can lead to thinking that you're invincible and you get away with it another time.
So that's an interesting point, actually, because in hindsight, again, and we're all professors in hindsight, but looking at it now, by my actions, by my decisions at that time, and I'm not taking anything away from the fact that I took the decision
mm-hmm.
when the master came out, because I did call the master at some stage, he didn't challenge me on it, and he kind of by not challenging backed me up. But that goes down the line, right? Okay. So I by doing that at that time, I gave the impression to, for instance, officers around me, like the second mate, that it was okay.
That was accepted.
It was accepted. Exactly.
Yeah.
I think that's a very critical point, actually. And if you would ask me now, do you regret it? I probably do.
Hindsight's a great thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you mentioned at the start of our conversation, and through that example you gave, which thank you for giving it, psychological safety.
Yep.
Now, we use it as a buzzword. We hear it a lot of times, kind of thing. And I'm guessing the feedback that I get sometimes is saying it doesn't make it, and I've heard that a few times, which is I think quite powerful. So we say it's a psychologically safe space, but just by saying it doesn't make it so. And I'm wondering, in your position, can you give us an idea of what you do to promote that psychologically safe space? Maybe?
Yeah, it's a great one. And again, I don't want to labour the point too much, but I think you're hitting on something here. I think we need to find ways to be more exemplary, almost making sure that we talk about examples, making sure that we, by the way, show it ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
But when we talk about it, that we don't constantly talk about psychological safety, because it may mean something for us, it may mean something for you, it definitely does mean something for me and quite a few others around us. But if you look at the broader perspective, there's a lot of people that they either don't understand it or they don't like it, right?
Yeah.
Because they feel it. What do you mean psychological safety? I mean, fundamentally, it's all about that environment again that I talked about before, where you're constantly taking actions, etc. That you can take actions, that you can say what you would like to do, sorry, that you can say what you would like to say and do what you would like to do without having to think twice about it, about what's happening in my environment, who else is watching, who else may be saying something about it. That for me is actually that psychological safety. Yeah. But I think we need to find ways where we can get more clarity with a few examples, etc. Effectively, that it starts to lift more for people. Okay. I go back to intervention because intervention is part of that psychological
safety. Yeah.
And I remember it when I was in my role as the DPA for the Shell fleet, and I remember having conversations because at that time intervention was the buzz.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
Everybody needs to be able to do an intervention. If I would talk to masters, you pick 100 masters, 100 of them would say, at their own fleet as well, right?
Yeah.
They were trained at it, 100 of them would say, if you would ask them, would you welcome intervention? 100 of them would say, oh yes, absolutely. Because they were kind of trained to say that.
Yeah.
Bear in mind, some of them were like right at the end of the spectrum, very good at it. Some of them were just saying because they knew they had to say it.
Right.
And then everything in between. But the point is, everybody would say that. But if you would then say, okay, can you now give me an example of something that you do that shows that you welcome that intervention? Because if you don't do that,
yeah.
If you just say it, then it's not going to work. I'll give you another example where I'm sitting next to a CEO during a verification visit.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sitting next to a CEO of a company. And he asked me to be part of that conversation. He was having a conversation with everybody that was not on watch, right? Predominantly Filipino crew, etc. Everybody listening, so the picture is the CEO and I sitting on a chair and the rest sitting over there. So that's generating something already, yeah? And the CEO is asking that question, do you all feel safe on board this vessel? Do you feel safe working for this company, right? And what do you get is nodding heads and smiles.
Affirmations and things. Easy.
Correct.
Yeah.
Easy, right? Okay. So anyway, so the conversation goes on, and at some stage he said, hey, do you have something? I said, well, I do have something with you. I said, there was just an overwhelming positive reflections on when you, Mr. CEO, were asking that question around whether everybody feels safe. Okay. Can we just deepen that conversation a little bit? And is anybody prepared and okay to share with us why that is?
Yeah.
Why do you feel safe to work for this company or on board this vessel compared to maybe something else?
Silence.
Right? Okay. Because you need to go a little bit deeper. Otherwise, it just stays.
It's almost like causal thinking, that asking that why. It's using those.
Correct. There's an interesting link to causal reasoning and causal thinking. There's no duration about it.
Because it's so easy to ask the question, and when you're asking almost a closed question, it's a positive or a negative, and as you say, most people respond in what they believe.
Back to your question, because again, I'm cautious about the fact that I may not have actually answered your question quite specifically. What do I think it's a lot about being interested, being honest, being humble, etc., and having conversations.
Mm.
Because I mean, ultimately, that's what it's about, isn't it?
Without a doubt,
by having that conversation, etc., and from that conversation flows a feeling that people will have. And that's why we feel it's so important that senior leaders visit vessels, talk to people on board the vessel, make it live, make it happen or whatever, have that conversation and show that you're also just a human person.
Yeah.
So share, not mistakes, but share your understanding that, you know, things are not always ideal, things will go wrong. You will face days that things appear to be against you all the time, etc. But how do you control that? How do you not let it be of influence of what you do and how you do it, etc. So for me, creating that sort of sense of, you know, I hate saying it, but being friends, I mean, that's when we get a little bit softy. But I think you get the point.
Having the respect and that.
And let me share another anecdote, and I may have mentioned, I definitely mentioned it to others, I hope that the story is not getting too stale, but I do recall during the Partners of Safety conference when we were introduced resilience for the very first time. So the VP for Shell Health on stage, big slide, big word, resilience. Right, okay. And that was a major challenge. Right, okay. And I remember sitting in the Rotterdam conference next to a CEO of a Belgian company. And whilst the conversation is going on, whilst the VP is doing the presentation, he's on his phone underneath the table and he's searching on Google for the word resilience. What does resilience actually mean? So we had a bit of a laugh about it when I saw it. I said, yeah, pay attention. Okay. But anyway, in the break, we ended up talking with each other. Yeah? And he said, listen, he said, I looked at it, I was on my phone Googling it, but he said, but I got it. He said, resilience actually means bringing back the bar on board ships.
Okay.
Right? Okay. And I had to think about it for a second. But if you peel back the onion, I mean, he had something there, isn't it? Because the point that he was making is, if you go back, and I hate going back in history, like, you know, in history everything is always better, which is not the case, right? Okay. But how can we take what was good and consider that today? Because what he was talking about was, how can you make sure that the team on board the vessel is really, really gelling? And everybody has each other's back, right? Okay. And that goes to the point that we're getting a little bit practical here, but that goes to the point that, you know, nowadays on a typical vessel, not everywhere, but on a typical vessel, you can see that whole sense, people will go to a cabin. They're on duty, they do the work, and they go to the cabin or whatever. They're online, they're communicating at home, which is equally important, don't get me wrong, but being in a room all together and looking at a Warport movie all together, and it breaks down, so let's be in a conversation. And a conversation about life and about your family and about home and everything. I think at that time, we were probably better able to have that sort of gelling, and I think we missed that a little bit at the moment. And whether it's on board a vessel, in a team ashore, or anywhere, if you don't have that sort of gelling, you're starting to miss them. You're starting to, things start to get a little bit more shaky, I think.
It's a really fair point, because I have a bit of self-reflection on myself there. So I was at sea also, and I remember quite vividly, the bar was mobbed, absolutely full. Every night people were in the bar socialising, darts, whatever it was. But that's how, so for me, it's building that bond.
Yeah.
So when we talk about psychological safety, there's an element of trust.
Trust is a good thing.
It's really important that we believe internally that the voice not only will be heard, but will be respected. And that's where I think that we sometimes struggle with building that trust aspect. Yeah. I mean, I'll share
trust
quite
is a great word, by the way.
Yeah. So obviously I was invited to the LT meeting on Monday.
Yeah.
And we were speaking about investigate and learn. And a bit of reflection on myself and Sarah, my boss, highlighted it to me, was in that meeting, I gave some honest feedback to the GMs.
Yeah.
But I did, before I mentioned it, I said, because I'm in a psychological safe space, and Sarah said, we want to get to a position where I don't have to say that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I should be able to say, give you honest feedback, and internally know that I'm going to be safe in doing so. Now, I didn't feel that I wasn't, but there's still something there, because I'm speaking to the GMs, that I wanted to kind of preempt that with, this is safe, now I'm going to give you some honest feedback. Now, I suppose that we are on a journey, and that gives me a wee bit of comfort. I don't think there's anything wrong with it. But I'm guessing what we want to get to it is, but that never has to happen. We just talk openly.
Correct. You're spot on. And then whilst you were talking, there were several things happening in my brain, because I actually done it. I can recall several conversations in the last couple of weeks or months where I have done exactly what you did. I remember in an Ockham meeting where I took quite a strong position on something, right? Okay, and I felt that would not necessarily land well with everybody. Right? So I made exactly the same statement, right? But it says something. It says that, one, that you're thinking about it, which, by the way, is very good, because what it does, it also maybe is of influence on how you're saying what you're going to be saying, because you will be respectful for the fact that there will be different opinions on it. You're going to be saying something that may not necessarily land well with everybody. So the fact that you think about it is okay. I think there will be a moment, I hope there will be a moment, that you don't have to say it anymore. will just be okay. So I think you're right, we're on the journey at the moment, so yeah. I recognise that completely.
And you mentioned we're on a journey, which makes sure we are still going, yeah. Hopefully we're up to 20 minutes, so I won't keep much more of your time.
Yeah.
I suppose just coming to an end, and you said we're on a journey. People are always going to ask, where does that journey take us? How long are we going to get to that? That I don't expect you to have an answer, but how do you see the journey for the next 3, 4, 5 years?
Yeah, that's a tough one. I thought the question was going to be different, and I was preparing myself to give you the answer that the journey is never over.
Okay.
Because I think there's always going to be progressive insight. There's always going to be new thinking and new ideas, etc. So I think although we just talked about it being a journey, but don't see it as a journey with an end or whatever. For me, it's more about learning, learner mindset, and that will never stop, is it?
Because
the world is changing, we are changing, our tools are changing, our insight, progressive insight, is changing, etc. So I find it difficult to just talk about, oh, you know, the next 2 years, the next 3 years.
Okay.
It, for me, it's just continuous. As a society, as an organization, as a company, as a team, I think you're on this sort of wheels of change constantly almost.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is fundamental to a learner mindset. That, you know, don't see it as an end or whatever, and then say, okay, so what's going to be next? No, it's just almost like a continuing process that you're
and
constantly doing.
Because you and I both worked for Shell for a long time, and we know that in 3 or 4 years there'll be some new word or new phase or new thing that we believe in. So I'm guessing it's our understanding that the stuff that we learn now, we continue past whatever that happens. So if there is a new thing, we don't just leave our learner mindset and our psychologically safe discussions, then we embed that moving forward. Then.
Part of the process, by the way, is stop doing things that were normal, by the way, 20 years ago. Go back to the example that I gave, that I regret, right? Okay, but at the time, I thought it was the right thing to do to protect the company, for being in the picture with the spill and that sort of stuff. So, but that's something you stop. So when you're on that journey, you learn new things, but you should also not be afraid to accept that what you used to do a year ago, 2 years ago, or 5 years ago, that's no longer good. Again, it's part of that continuing development or whatever.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Ed.
You're most welcome.
20 minutes. I'm really keen to hear your feedback, so I will post this once Ed's agreed on it on Yammer, and I'll maybe do another one and capture some other unlikely GM as they walk past. Thanks very much. Thank you, Ed.
Appreciate it. Thank you.